Now joining me, Tim Ferriss. Welcome to What's Trending. Now in honor of your new book, The 4-Hour Chef, we're making 4-Minute Ceviche. Ooh. Yeah, very fancy. All right, so let's start with the process. And let's talk a bit about your book and what's going on. So first we start with shrimp.
Yes, very important component. You can use shrimp, you can use fish, but most people don't experiment with shrimp enough. So small,
and this is not ready to eat though.
We should not eat the shrimp tartare. I would discourage.
Yeah.
So once you cover, let's say, a pound of these small shrimp with 1 cup of lime juice, which will kill the bacteria
and also limes, cook it. How do you chop limes? You're like a master chopper now.
I was a culinary idiot my whole life, which is part of the reason I wanted to tackle cooking as a way to demonstrate how to learn anything, because I sucked at it. I mean, the only time I was ever famous online for cooking was for microwaving liquid egg whites in plastic containers. That's the only one.
So,
delicious. So, all right, let's assume that we.
But now, is this because you wanted to, you know, get in with the women? You wanted to be a great chef? Seem to be a master at everything. Like, how can you do that?
Well, I wanted to take something that I was terrible at to show people the process from start to finish. So like all the stumbling, all the screw-ups, and how I apply things like smart drugs or modeling people like Daniel Tammet, who learned Icelandic in 7 days well enough to do an interview on TV. Whether you want to shoot a basketball, whether you want to sear a steak, learn Spanish in 8 to 12 weeks, there's actually one process that you can apply to all of them.
And what is it?
Called meta-learning.
Okay, meta-learning.
Yeah. Meta-learning. Yeah.
All right, let's
Well, let's talk about knives.
Let's learn this lime cutting right now. How do you chop these limes? Because you have a way of chopping. Because for me, I feel like I chop, like, all right, so this is like a typical knife. and I chop, like, I'm just like, hey, I'm chopping the lime. Yep. Is there like a better way of doing this? I feel like, you know, people are scared when they see me chop because they
I was afraid you're gonna cut it off your thumb, right?
All right.
So I was that way for a long time. My mom, like all good moms, I think, gave me one or two knives after graduating from school and just sat there in a block like furniture for years and years. All right, so this type of knife is not good for learning knife skills.
Really?
Not at all.
Put that to the side.
Neither is this. The reason being, good chef's knives have this type of riser right here. So you'll hear a lot of chefs recommend, well, buy the most expensive knife you can afford. I don't think that's good advice. This is a Rada knife. This is like $7, $7 to $9.
Okay, so it's not even expensive.
It's rounded on the end so you can't poke yourself. This is sharp, but what it allows you to do is practice the proper grip. Here's what it looks like. Most people don't realize this. It's very similar to golf, actually. So you have three fingers here, and then you pinch the blade.
No way.
So that's what it looks like.
That's really interesting. And we'll have all the instructions, the ingredients, and his little gadgets in the description below this video when it's up. Yeah. And so that's how you, and then you chop it.
So there, I never used knives before this book for cooking. For other things, yes. But what you're going to do is make a dim mock hand position like that. Check it out. That's like the death touch, okay? And you have blood sport style, right? And you're just having your ring finger and your index touch and then your middle, and that is gonna protect your hand. And then you curl it in. So check it out. The knife is always in contact with this knuckle on my middle finger.
Okay.
I can't cut myself. I cannot. It is impossible. And then from here, you're gonna be cutting like so. And that is how you cut without ever cutting yourself.
That's very interesting. Yeah. It seems like hard though. Like I just want to do things. I'm like hippy dippy cook.
You don't want to be too loosey goosey with like samurai swords.
But I'm like, yo, what's up?
But literally in an afternoon, you could buy an encyclopedia, 500-page book on knife skills, and it will just overwhelm you. You can get to a point in about 2 hours with the proper progression where you're cutting like this, and I could be looking at you and not cut my fingers. You can get there in an afternoon. It doesn't have to be complicated.
That's amazing. All right, so once you cut all of this, you have the limes,
You
have tomatoes, you slice and dice, and the avocado.
Yep.
And then and then what about this? We have these, the mint. So what is this, mint?
Cilantro and basil. cilantro and basil. No, but check this out.
I'm obviously a woman that cooks, as you can imagine.
You're the next Julia Child, I think.
Yes.
But I want to point something out, and that was, for about a year, I was trying to pick up cooking just as a hobby, and I would ask my girlfriend over and over again, like, is this basil? What is this? Is this basil? No, it's not basil. What is this? Basil. I could not remember flavors. So there's actually sort of an approach, like learning vocabulary, to picking up flavors, like collecting them.
Well, I feel like it's either in your DNA or not.
No. Because here's the thing. I could not cook. Before the book, I had Emily and Rob of a company called Foodsy come over and visit. And they're like, we'll help you cook dinner. Great, come on over. They're like, where's your olive oil? In my, oh, it's in the freezer. They're like, why is your olive oil in the freezer?
Okay, that's really dumb. I even heard that.
No, I know, but that's where I was.
And so you chop these up.
Yeah, chop these up.
You would make them into how small? How would you describe?
As small as you like. I mean, here's the thing. With it, the more finely you chop anything, just like brewing coffee, the finer the grounds are, the more you're going to extract flavor, okay? All so right. Garlic press, stronger flavor than big
So it ends up, we didn't really do it, but it ends up looking like this,
like
right?
Yeah.
Want to check that out?
Yeah. Delicious.
And so that is that the final
Yeah, so here's what it looks like. You would have this, put it in a bowl, you have a pound of shrimp, cup of lime, cover it, leave it alone. I leave it overnight. And
but
then,
overnight isn't 4 hours.
No, I know, but you're not touching it. What matters is hands-on time. Hands-on time.
Okay, so that's the whole principle of the 4 hour. Everything, your whole brand is the 4 hour this, and I always would make fun of you kind of.
Of course.
And I'd be like, oh, okay, four hours. Yeah, really, it takes 4 hours? And like, that's not realistic.
The 4 hour marriage, the 4 hour ninja.
But then it's not like it really takes 4 hours. It's like the actual work time. Is that what you mean by it?
What people miss, I think, oftentimes, is that the objective is, whether it's the 4 hour work week, 4 hour body, 4 hour chef, to show you the fewest number of steps, the most elegant path from A to B, right? So uncommon solutions. What I mean by that is, if you want to make osso buco for like 4 to 6 people, the prep time is like 5 minutes. It's easier than making scrambled eggs for one person.
Yeah.
And in this particular case, all you're doing is pouring lime juice on top of shrimp and then leaving it overnight, and you're done. And then for the next night, the next afternoon.
And then you just add, that's when you add this, you add these, crunch them up, and you get some of this. And then why do we have these tortillas?
I'm not sure. Ceviche tortillas, I guess. Ceviche burritos.
This is if you want to add some carbs to the table.
Yeah,
that's how you serve it, I guess.
You could serve it on this. You could certainly serve it on, let's say, a lettuce leaf. What I like to do, this is just a trick from, let's say, Jacques Pepin or any of these chefs. That was how I massacre French. I can't speak French, but check it out.
You're my favorite elitist friend ever.
No, the thing is, I like to be like the guy who pretends to be the wine snob.
But you're not, but I know you're
a
dude. But
you have I'm from Long Island.
You have a dude vibe to you.
Yeah.
So how does a dude become so knowledgeable about a master? Like, I mean, what is this thing?
Oh, this is to make me look very professional. It's kind of like, it's like doctors on TV that wear their scrubs, even if they're like,
So what is
dentists,
that?
And you're like, why are scrubs?
It's in case I poured this all over you or
this,
something?
This is, really good chefs don't use pot holders. They use something like this. This is actually something I found. Tom Colicchio uses these. This is a surgical lint-free huck towel. It's not even for cooking. And you can use this for just about everything. It costs $1 a piece. And this is an example of like the minimal effective dose, like the fewest things that you need. You get this, let's say, you get an AeroPress for the best coffee you've ever had, learn to do it upside down like the world champion baristas, you get one of these, spend like $20 on, on a Dutch oven skillet combo, you're done. You don't need a lot of stuff.
You live the life.
I like to test all the ridiculous nonsense so other people don't have to.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I mean, I appreciate that. So the big thing about 4 Hour Chef, which is your third book, it seems like a trilogy almost.
So it is a trilogy. No, honestly, like not like Star Wars, but one of my elders is Ben Franklin, and he had Healthy, Wealthy, and Wise. And so my three obsessions have been like healthy, 4 Hour Body, Wealthy, the 4 hour work week stuff, and then Wise is the learning. I mean, I was neuroscience in school. Ever since then, I've been obsessed with this stuff. So the last book is the Wise piece. The 4 hour chef is how to learn. It's how to learn anything.
So that's the end of Tim Ferriss. You're done after this.
Then it's off to, exactly. Tobago,
prequels.
Philippines. Prequels, The five hour chef.
But the big difference with this book, let's talk about the model because
absolutely.
You're being boycotted.
Yeah.
I want to say let's eat while we talk about this, but I'm worried that you're scared of eating this right now.
Oh, I could eat. I could eat the sauce with a spoon. I'll try this.
So tell me about. Don't eat it. Oh. Don't eat it.
Oh yeah, I won't. Actually, you know what? In the interest of food safety, I will chew on the cilantro.
All right. So while we talk about boycotting, let's chew on some cilantro.
Some people genetically can't eat this. It tastes like soap to them. I'm not kidding.
I was just going to say, no, it doesn't taste like soap to me. Why is Barnes & Noble boycotting you? But you're a nice guy. Why would they do that?
They hate me. No. Because The 4 Hour Chef is the first major book out of Amazon Publishing. So Amazon, so Amazon is stepping into new territory, and a lot of incumbents are very afraid.
Mm-hmm.
So Amazon Publishing launched in New York City, and this is their big litmus test in the eyes of a lot of people, certainly insiders in the publishing world. And what Barnes & Noble wants to do is make an example out of me. They mm-hmm. want to say, without us, your books fail, and then scare authors away from working with Amazon. But in effect, the way I view that is, all right, that is trying to intimidate authors into not trying anything new, anything that threatens the old model.
Of course.
And yeah. I've had a lot of good experiences in bookstores. I love some bookstores like Omnivore Books in San Francisco, but ultimately, if you don't care enough about your customer, your end user, that bothers me. Mm-hmm. And so they're boycotting, so 1,000+ stores. I think the 4-Hour Chef.
That's crazy.
I think the 4-Hour Chef is actually the most banned book in the U.S. since Lady Chatterley's Lover in 1928.
You are creating a movement, my friend.
Yeah.
So, you know, when there's disruption, there's something going on.
Yeah. And so right? to get around that.
And then also you made a big announcement today, which you're going to talk about here. We're like the first place you're talking about this.
Yeah. Big content partnership with BitTorrent.
So, crazy.
If incumbents thought I was scary before, just wait.
Watch out, all
and,
of you.
And so I've had to take a very unconventional sort of guerrilla warfare approach with, let's say, the trailer.
Yeah, which has gotten over 1 million views. Congratulations
Thank
on
you.
YouTube.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah, so the 4-Hour Chef cinematic trailer is the most, I think now the most viewed nonfiction book trailer of all time since it posted last week.
That's amazing.
Beating out Boo, the world's cutest dog. For the top slot. I'm
when
sorry.
When you beat out babies and dogs, awesome. You know you have something special.
Exactly.
And so you're really creating a new model for all authors out there and people that want to create and put something out for a community.
I'm hoping so. I mean, I'm doing exactly what I do when I research my books, which is testing a lot of things, throwing it out there, seeing what works, and then hopefully people can take those best practices and use them. We'll find out.
Well, Tim, you rock. It was such a pleasure having you on today. And thank you for showing us all of this. You can make it yourself. Buy whatever he talked about today. It's in the description below. And the book is 4-Hour Chef, The Simple Path to Cooking Like a Pro, Learning Anything and Living the Good Life, which is always a good thing. It's available on Amazon this Tuesday, but not at Barnes & Noble. For more info, check out 4hourchef.com or follow him, Tim, on Twitter at T. Ferris. Yeah, exactly.